Hello students, after reading this module, you shall be able to know the development of gender roles, learn about gender socialization and family influence on its development, understand the theories explaining gender socialization, dividing people into groups is a cognitive process that appears to be inevitable in human beings. These groups can be divided on the basis of age, race, religion, caste, nationality, and many other variables. However, the division which is most common is the division of people on the basis of their gender. When we meet a new person, we instantly determine their gender. And this process of dividing people on the basis of their gender is habitual as well as automatic. It is almost unimaginable to inhibit humans' inclination to see their surroundings and hence the world in parts, gender being the most important variable to make this division. When we observe the world in two parts, that is males and females, we are likely to believe all males similar, all females similar, and the groups of males and females being distinct from each other. Actually, the male and female characteristics are overlapping. However, unfortunately, this gender categorization does create a false distinction between men and women and passes on gender roles which get difficult to alter in the course of time. Social and behavioral norms, which are usually considered suitable for either a man or a woman in a social or an interpersonal relationship by a particular society, are called gender roles. The perception of gender roles also includes personality traits, actions, and attitudes related to a particular gender in the given culture. Gender roles are preponderantly viewed in a familial perspective and within a society as well, and they are together stated as gender stereotypes. As we know, the basis of gender roles is culture. Although most of the cultures report just two genders, others report more. Example, androgyny is suggested as a third gender in some cultures. Some other cultures do even assert they have observed more than five genders, and few non-Western cultures maintain that they have three genders, male, female, and transgender. And the gender roles, when expressed, are known as gender expression, and they are seen as an external expression of a person's gender identity, which is determined by feminine, masculine, or gender-varying or gender-neutral behavior, body characteristics, clothing, and hairstyles. Gender stereotypes for males and females. Stereotypes represent the shaped understanding of traditions, myths, thoughts, religions, and sciences of a particular society. With this knowledge, stereotypes or beliefs about a certain group are developed. Social psychologists believe stereotypes are just a component of a person's social knowledge. According to this knowledge, stereotypes have an effect on individual social behavior. Stereotype behavior can be associated to the process of how the stereotype was acquired, communicated, and distorted. This depicts a person's socialization process too. Individuals' culture influences stereotypes by information obtained from indirect sources such as parents, teachers, peer groups, political and religious leaders, and the mass media. To understand stereotyping, one must be acquainted with the definition of a stereotype. Stereotypes are schemas which represent how an individual perceives other people, especially those outside his or her group. What the individual believes to be standard is related to who he or she is socializing with, who are usually his or her friends, and social system. Gender stereotypes are associated to cognitive processes, as there are different expectations as to how a man or a woman should behave, and these traditional gender roles serve to maintain gender stereotypes. For example, men are thought as being assertive, independent, aggressive, adventurous, and task-oriented, whereas women are believed to be more gentle, dependent, sensitive, emotional, and people-oriented. But obviously, every man doesn't have the power and can arrogantly dominate women. In reality, a lot of men are dominated by the system of the society. Also, women are provided with few advantages and protected in some ways that men can't enjoy. Clearly, each gender has and uses power in some ways and is becoming more equal, but clearly, they aren't equal yet. Dissociating gender wholly from all personality traits is the latest proposition given as a solution to this problem. Although the women are inferior outlook is subdued and hidden within today's career-oriented families, but the antiquated expectations based on their sex role are still elusively present. The older regulations still function as put-down women and keep them in their place. Men and women have a few biological differences, but it is primarily their life experiences that reinforce or contradict those biological differences. The truth of different behaviors exhibited by men and women lies in different patterns of socialization, which asserts that men and women are taught different behaviors appropriate for their gender. Gender socialization. Socialization is the process in the course of which a child develops into an individual who respects his or her environment's laws, norms, and customs. Gender socialization is a focused pattern of socialization where boys and girls are socialized into their gender roles and are taught about the meaning of being a male or a female. The socialization begins the moment the child is born, marked by the simple question whether the child is a boy or a girl. Individuals learn their gender roles by the authorities of society. Majorly, the authorities in Western society are the parents, peers, schools, and the media. With respect to socialization of gender roles, each of the authorities could strengthen the gender stereotypes. Socialization process results in gender differences among males and females, particularly during their childhood and adolescence. The classical example of gender socialization is the experiment done with babies, where they were introduced as males to half of the study subjects and as females to the other half. The participants behaved differently according to the sex they had been told. The results are interesting and quite disturbing at the same time. These results illustrate that other people in society contribute very much as how an individual sees himself or herself based on his or her gender. Family influence on gender socialization. Usually, parents are the chief authority considering the development of gender roles in the initial years of one's life. The family is characterized with a specific way of living, unlike other groups in the society, and is responsible for creating gender differences by a process that is certainly biological, but is also social and relational. The family is a symbolic and social place where differences, in particular sexual differences, are supposed to be basic and simultaneously created. Particularly, the gender depiction in a family reflects the individualism of the parents. Therefore, in a family, the relation of a child with the mother and the father has a primary significance in the definition of the child's gender belonging, as it is the first and the most basic understanding of relation with the females and males. Also, there are various other ways and behaviors through which parents can educate their children about stereotypes. The manner of dressing up their child, the manner of setting their child's room, the playthings given to their child, and their own behavior and attitudes. Gender identities and the associated expectations about female and male roles are socialized as a result of the parents-child relationship. In the early days, families had varied educational requirements for their daughters and sons after puberty, so they learned to distinguish females and males in a way to promote the self-sufficiency in the males and the reliance in the females. It was implied that the boy must aim for self-fulfillment even if he has to go against familial relationships, whereas the girl had to agree to preserve those relationships in almost all of the ways. This difference has led to an implied fact that young women live their wish of independence and self-sufficiency with a sense of guiltiness. Theories of gender socialization. Gender is internalized through an individual's relations with those around him or her. In sociological vocabulary, the person being socialized is the target of socialization. The people, groups, and institutions who are involved in the process of socializing a child are the agents of socialization. All theories of gender socialization have the same opinion that communication with the society is the fundamental method by which socialization takes place. So, gender socialization should be studied at an interactional level. Social learning theory. Social learning theory was a result of behaviorism. Behaviorists claimed that all behaviors in humans were learned through life experiences. So they were concerned about finding exactly how we acquire those behaviors. Their chief explanation is that learning occurs through a series of rewards and punishments. An infant smiling for the first time is rewarded by his or her parents in the form of attention, praise, or affection. The first smile is rewarded, and therefore there are chances that the infant will try to smile once more in the near future. When a child drops his plate of food or breaks a toy, he or she may not be scolded, but he is also not receiving any reward. This is basically how individuals learn according to social learning theory. Through selective rewarding, withholding rewards, or punishing behaviors. Social learning theorists have also keyed out particular sex type behaviors when a behavior is anticipated more and hence seen as apt when executed by one sex, but less anticipated and hence seen as inapt when executed by the other gender, is a sex type behavior. According to social learning theorists, socialization of gender occurs when children are rewarded for indulging in gender type behavior which is consistent with their allocated gender category. The typical illustration is weeping. On weeping or crying, it is more likely that a girl will be comforted while a boy will be scolded and taught that boys don't cry. Hence, crying is a gender type behavior and gender socialization occurs with these kinds of interactions. Cognitive development theory. Piaget emphasized on the stages of child's cognitive development. This theory of child development brought a new perspective to gender socialization, which is generally called cognitive development theory. This perspective attempts to describe the process used by children for developing gender identity as well as the ability to gender type themselves and others, and this is learned as they develop through a series of fixed, discrete developmental stages. Throughout the stages, there is an emphasis on how a child actively develops a perspective of gender and based on this knowledge, then actively socializes him or her instead of being passive object of socialization. The first stage occurs in early childhood, that is, 2.5 to 3 years of age, when children attain gender identity. In this first stage, Children should be capable of accurately identifying their own gender and identifying the gender of others around them too. According to the theory, children have acquired gender stability by the age of 5 years, which is the next stage. Gender stability leads to an understanding in children that gender is permanent and it is the gender that will be for the rest of their lives. That is, once a boy has achieved gender stability, he understands in general that he cannot become a mother. The final phase, according to the theory, is gender constancy, which is not attained until the age of 7 years. With the understanding of gender constancy, children build up the complex understanding that a man dressed as a woman, that is wearing a woman's clothes, makeup or a wig, is still essentially a male. This concept makes the child understand that changes in physical appearance of an individual do not alter their underlying gender category. Up until the final stage, a child's perceptive of gender is narrow and is based on very tangible rules. Example, girls play with dolls and boys play with toy trucks or cars. Gender schema theory. Gender schema theory was developed by Sandra Byrne. She critiqued cognitive development theory because she felt that it didn't provide explanations regarding why children socialize themselves on the basis of their gender particularly. Byrne questioned how the category of gender and not other available categories like race, religion, or culture were the ordering principle of the identities of children. She noted that in cognitive development theory, children appear to mostly socialize themselves in the lack of any external societal force to act in a gender stereotype manner. Hence, her gender schema theory attempts to rectify this deviation from the external pressures important to social learning theory by determining a balance between the two theories. The central concept in this theory is schemas, which Byrne in 1983 defined as a cognitive structure and network of associations that helps to organize an individual's perception of the world. According to gender schema theory, schemas are helping to systematize received and perceptions from the environment. They serve a sort of classifying and organizing function. They also determine the way people search for and understand info and also which type of info they incorporate into their thinking process. Schemas also take into account the complicated ways in which the information is interconnected, as the info regarding mother may also be connected to woman, female, nurturer, caretaker, and many others. The presence of this information in schemas then decides the definite method in which people experience their surroundings. That is, if there is a schema about mothers which includes the mentioned characteristics, so one might be more heedful to mothers who are consistent with all these qualities and become less probable to recognize the mothers who do not. Schemas also become lenses that shape the way in which people see their world. So gender schemas are cognitive structures that allow people to arrange certain features and actions into groups of male and female, and next build a range of other connections with those groups. Like schemas, gender schemas also gradually lead to shape the ways in which people perceive the world around them through the lenses of gender. Gender schema theory poses that rather than rose-colored glasses, we all live with gendered colored glasses that lead us to see the world in some very specifically gendered ways. Primary gender socialization. Primary gender socialization is basically the first process of acquiring and behaviors, customs, and traditions of the society or the group that an individual belongs to in infancy and childhood, and it is communicated through the primary groups to which he or she belongs. Primary groups are defined as having enduring and unspecialized and intimate relations among small groups who generally spend ample of time together. Primary socialization commences prior to even the birth of the baby, before the baby is born in a society with some presumptions about gender that has been in the society long before they were born in. The relative value placed on any gender in the society is important to infant socialization. Around the world, more value is placed on male infants as compared to female infants in a lot of societies. In majority of the cultures, only the sons can carry the family name because daughters have to adopt their husband's name after their marriage. Sons may be in charge for looking after the needs of their older parents or for rituals significant to religious and family life. For example, in the Hinduism, important rituals related to a parent's death should usually be carried out by the son. The grounds for this preference for boys differ, but it has significant effects on the gender socialization of both boys and the girls. Secondary gender socialization. Secondary groups are typically more temporary, larger, more specialized, and more impersonal than primary groups. Few examples of secondary groups may be business organizations, college classes. Secondary groups tend to be more specialized than primary groups, as they emphasize on few prime goals. Every time a person joins a group or an institution, he or she needs to find out the standards and regulations of that group of individuals or of that institution. Hence, secondary socialization is a learning process that occurs every time an individual joins one of the new secondary groups. Summary. The social and behavioral norms that are generally considered appropriate by a particular society for either a man or a woman in a social or interpersonal relationship are called gender roles. Gender roles are preponderantly viewed in a family context as well as within a society and may collectively be stated as gender stereotypes. Family plays a pivotal role in the development of gender roles and gender stereotypes. Different theories explain different perspectives on the process of development of gender socialization.